So there is a lot of papers in literature using the same methodology, and I will now show some failures that were reported and some improvement of the method. So the first failure was observed for LINFIB-04. When the same methodology were used for the system with GGA calculation, actually, as you can see, the formation energy of every intermediate composition are negative. So it means that we will predict a solid solution behavior between LINFIB-04 and IFIB-04. But experimentally, everyone knows that we actually have a two-phase domain. So this is the limits of the GGA method. So the GGA method, in that case, does not reproduce well the localized electron in the 3D orbitals. So in order to have a good agreement between the calculated phase diagram and the experimental one, one has to use GGA plus U method to better treat this strongly correlated electron. So this is a different shape for the formation energy curve versus the lithium content, depending on the U value. So the U parameter then is a bit tricky because you have to adjust the value to the system you want to study. So this is, if you got 1 eV, we still predict a solid solution behavior. And it's only for U value above 3 eV, actually, that we start to predict positive formation energy between FEP04 and LIFEP04. So this will agree with the experimental data, because this will, okay, if it's positive formation energy, it means that these phases are not stable, and we will have a two-phase domain. We will have a phase separation. So this is a case where only GGA was not good enough to reproduce the experimental work, and we have to switch to DFT plus U. More recently, we have been working on the sodium chromate oxide system. We were interested in understanding the phase transformation occurring during sodium deinterpolation. And as you can see in the electrochemical curve, we have again a set of voltage plateau and voltage jump. And all of this intermediate phase are due to the formation of ordering in the material. We have sodium, different kind of sodium vacancy ordering in the intersubstrate space. And so my colleague at MIT, Charlie Meg, she wanted to simulate the phase diagram for this system. And she was using GGA or GGA plus U. But as you can see, none of these methods, so this is the voltage versus the sodium content, and none of this method actually is giving a good agreement with the experimental curve. So it's again a failure. So in that case, the GGA plus U method is not good enough to reproduce well the complex behavior of this system. And it's actually these phases are very complex because they exhibit metallic-like conductivity, but they also exhibit Q-device behavior. So it means that the way of calculating the electronic structure is very complicated because you have to reproduce well these two characters, some delocalized electron and some more localized one. So for such a very complex system, we are thinking about using more evoluted methods like dynamical mean field theory, DMFT, that are more suitable for such complex systems. So now we'll give some example on the second part concerning the electronic structure. So use of DFT calculation to have information about the electronic structure. The first example will deal with the redox processes. So I will give an example with a material with three different transition metal ions. So nickel 1/3, cobalt 1/3, manganese 2/3. It's 1/3, it's a typo. So it's 1/3, 1/3, 1/3 material. And in that case, experimentally, the transition metal ions are not ordered, but for DFT calculation, we have to consider some kind of ordering. So this is the cell we have been using. So we ordered cobalt, manganese, and nickel in the E-plane. And we computed the electronic structure. So this is the spin density of states, partial, total and partial integrate on the cobalt, nickel and manganese. And based on this analysis, we can predict that we will have a low spin cobalt 3 plus, nickel 2 plus ion, and manganese 4 plus ion. And this was further confirmed by Zanes experiment with my colleague Mingzhou Wang in Taiwan. Then, in order to predict and understand the redox process, we also computed the spin density of states for different lithium content. So this was the initial phase. Then for lithium 2/3, then we see that we don't have nickel 2 plus anymore, but we do have low spin nickel 3 plus. So from 1 to 2/3, we oxidize nickel 2 plus into nickel 3 plus. Then for lithium 1/3, we have low spin nickel 4 plus appearing. So then we further oxidize nickel 3 plus into nickel 4 plus. And at the very end of the lithium deintegration, towards lithium amount equal to zero, we observe the formation of cobalt 4 plus ion. So we have the picture here, nickel 2 plus toward nickel 3 plus, then 3 plus, nickel 3 plus to nickel 4 plus, and finally cobalt 3 plus into cobalt 4 plus. We can also compute the theoretical voltage expected for these different redox couples. So this is a redox couple nickel 3 plus, nickel 2 plus, 2 plus 3 plus, 3 plus 4 plus, and finally the cobalt redox couple. And this, the shape is in good agreement with the experimental electrochemical curve. The redox processes, I didn't put here the Xanes data, but the redox processes was also confirmed by in situ Xanes study by the group of Bingzhou Wang. The second example deals with the electronic structure of the defects in overstoichiometric Li CO2. So now I am talking about the stable form of Li CO2, so it's an O3 type of stacking. It can actually be synthesized with an excess of lithium. And from our previous work, so this is a typical formula we can get. And the cycling curves are different. For stoichiometric Li CO2, we have a two-phase domain here, and the formation of a lithium vacancy ordering for 0.5. But for the other stoichiometric phase, we don't have any of this feature. The curve is much more smooth. From our previous work, based on magnetic properties and solid-state lithium mass NMR, we built an hypothesis for the defect to explain the presence of excess of lithium in this material. So we believe the lithium is going on a cobalt site, but we also believe that we have actually cobalt 3 plus oxidation states. So to charge compensate, then we have an oxygen vacancy. So these defects will generate the presence of two cobalt in a square-based pyramid site, so it's not octahedral site anymore. And because of this specific geometry, we think this cobalt ion exhibits an intermediate spin configuration. So these are paramagnetics, whereas in the standard Li CO2, the cobalt are low spin, cobalt 3 plus, and they are diamagnetic. So more recently, in order to further investigate the defects in this material, we have been doing a Xanes study, so comparing the stoichiometric sample to the other stoichiometric one. As you can see, at the cobalt KH or cobalt LH, the shape are not so different. The main difference was observed for the oxygen KH. As the oxygen KH, as you can see, for the red curve, for the lithium LiCO2, the other stoichiometric LiCO2, we have a different additional bound here at low energy supercell with a diluted defect. So it's LiCO2 and we have in one layer over two. So this layer is a normal layer like in the stoichiometric LiCO2. But in one layer of R2, we introduce some of the defects. So also in plane, the defect is diluted. So we only have here two cobalts in a square-based pyramid, and the other cobalt are in normal octahedral size. If we compute the spin dose for the cobalt ion in the material, so in blue it's the cobalt of the normal layer, like in LiCO2, we find a low spin cobalt 3+, as expected. But in the layer with the defect, we have both. We have low spin, also low spin cobalt 3+, here in blue. And we have also the cobalt 3+ located in a square-based pyramid in red. And as you can see, this cobalt does exhibit very different spin density of states that we can interpret with this picture, with this intermediate spin configuration. So now, instead of having diamagnetic cobalt 3+, we have paramagnetic cobalt 3+, with unpaired electron in the dz orbital, if we call this the direction towards the oxygen vacancy. And the other unpaired electron is located in one of the T2g orbital, and this one is actually the T2g that is pointing towards now the missing edge. Because of the oxygen vacancy, we remove the common edge between the cobalt octahedra, and the T2g pointing towards this edge is the one that is carrying the spin. We also can compute the partial density of states on the 2p level of oxygen, and we could interpret our Zanes spectrum based on these states will correspond to these empty states. And the additional feature that we were observing in the over stoichiometric LiCO2 are due to the presence of these additional states due to the formation of intermediate spin cobalt 3+ ion. My third last example for the electronic structure concerns the LiLiPo4 material we have been working on. We can synthesize LiVPO4F or LiVOPO4, and these two materials have similar structure with a tavorite-like structure. And the most striking difference is locally the vanadium octahedral distances. In LiVPO4F, the vanadium octahedra are pretty symmetric. But in LiVOPO4, as you can see, we have a short VO distance and a long one. So we have alternatively very long and very short distances. And we wanted to understand better the electronic structure for this material, especially because if we compare the two systems from the electrochemical properties point of view, we see, so in both systems we can intercalate or deintercalate lithium, and we will focus more on the vanadium 4, vanadium 3 redox couple. So here in LiVPO4F, if we deintercalate lithium, we have a pretty high voltage plateau here. And in LiVPO4, if we intercalate lithium, we have a set of different phase transitions, but the voltage is much lower. In these two cases, it's the same redox copper that is active, vanadium 4+, vanadium 3+, but we have almost 2 volts of voltage difference for the same redox copper. So this was a striking difference. And we could explain this difference by the formation of a vanadium bond in LiV PO4O. As you can see, this is a 3D charge density map. We have a strong covalent VO bond here compared to other bonds. So this corresponds to the short VO distance. And if we analyze the spin density of states, we see that the spin is localized in only one of the T2G orbitals. So this together is in agreement with the formation with a strong vanadyl bond. So I will go fast on this. We can also compute the Bader charge analysis. We did the Bader charges analysis, and we show that the formation of the vanadyl bond is actually, because it's strongly covalent, is actually it's actually the one that is responsible for the decreasing of the voltage. Then the vanadium is less ionic, so the voltage for the V3 plus, V4 plus couple is much lower than in the case of the purely fluorine materials, where the vanadium is much more ionic. So I will go very fast. On the last part, I will have only one example of the diffusion of lithium in LiCO2. So as Andy presented yesterday, we use the nudge elastic bond method to calculate the diffusion path. And what it was interesting in this study, it was made by Anton van der Wende some years ago, is that we can compute the activation energy but depending on the lithium concentration. So this is a path, the lithium goes through this tetrahedral site before going to the next adjacent octahedral site. And he was building different supercells in order to calculate the activation barrier as a function of the lithium content. And what was interesting is that for low lithium content, actually, if lithium is very diluted, the activation barrier is very high. If lithium is more concentrated, the activation barrier is much lower. So it will mean that the lithium diffusion will be faster if you have more lithium than if you have less lithium. And this is because in the diluted case, then we do have a lot of cobalt 4 plus ion 4. And because intermediate state is a tetrahedral site that is sharing a face with the cobalt octahedra, then we will have a stronger electrostatic repulsion through this common face. So it makes these sites less stable than in the case where we have more lithium. So it was a nice study, and they further compared the diffusion activation barrier between lithium and sodium horizon. So I'm concluding. Just I hope I give you some by some example. I convince you that the FT calculation is a powerful tool to help understanding the electrode material for sodium ion battery. And I will thank my colleagues, students, financial support, and thank you for your attention.